But at least she's healthy.
Yeah. Spring lost the fight.
How are you?
She got a lot.
Yeah, he works at my house. Afternoon.
Afternoon.
I am Pastor Russ Leifert. I am covering for Velva during their absence of a pastor. So bear with me. And thank you all for coming on behalf of the family. It'll be kind of simple. Blessed be God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the source of all mercy and the God of all consolation. He comforts us in all our sorrows so that we can comfort others in their sorrows with the consolation we ourselves have received from God. And your response is, thanks be to God.
Thanks be to God.
Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Thank you, O God of grace and glory. We remember before you today our sister Donna. We thank you for giving her to the family to know and to love as a companion in their pilgrimage on earth. In your boundless compassion, console those who mourn. Give your aid so that we may see in death the gate to eternal life, that we may continue our course on earth in confidence until by your call we are all reunited with those who have gone before us. For your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And at this time, I'll ask you to come up and talk about Donna.
So when I was getting ready to prepare my thoughts, I was thinking about some of the characteristics and reflecting back about my grandmother. Some things came to mind, like she's a hard worker. I really admired that about her. She had to be. She had to raise five children on a waitress's salary, and it was a difficult life for her. And she was feisty. She had a lot of tenacity about her. One of the things about having to, from growing up in the Depression to having to raise five children, it made her very thrifty. And that is one of the things that I really enjoyed about her, was going to the thrift store. I picked up my thrift habits from her. And she always used to call going to the thrift store, finding your treasures. What treasures did you find today, Tree? She also kept track of every single penny that she ever, I remember she used to have a notebook and she'd write down whatever would be for a stamp back in the day. And one time when I was visiting her, I remember she wanted to go to the grocery store, and she pulled out underneath her bed, she had all these canned goods, and she had marked how much she paid for them, the date she bought, and the date she bought them, and she had two cases full of canned tomatoes. I thought it was kind of quirky. Another quirky thing that she saved every bit of wax paper, styrofoam cups. One time when I was visiting her, I like to tell this story because she said, Tree, do you know you can take the butter wrappers and butter the cake pans if you're making a cake. And I said, yes, Grandma, I know about that. And then she handed me a butter wrap to take back with me to Minneapolis on the train. And I said, Grandma, thank you, but I'm okay. But so other things that she enjoyed doing, she really enjoyed looking at recipes.
Good cook.
she was not the best cook. She was not known for her culinary skills, but she always wanted to be. When I came up to visit her about a month and a half ago, and just to talk to her about her childhood, and I asked her what some of her famous dishes were and that she cooked, and she recognized that she wasn't the best cook, but she said, kidney bean hot dish. And I remember she had told me about, she used to make these pork chops, and she'd put Coca-Cola in them. she wasn't the best cook, but that's just one of the quirky things about my grandmother. When I was growing up, because I was in that in between, I had spent a couple summers with her when I was 15 years old, and again when I was 17 years old. And it was during this time that I spent time with her best friend Shirley. She talked about growing up on the farm and meeting Shirley and growing up with Shirley. And I do remember that Shirley brought out the best in my grandmother. I remember smiling a lot, and her being in a really in good spirits surely had that effect on her. And also, she had got married to Walt, and Walt too really brought out the best in my grandmother. What gives me comfort now is knowing that they're up there welcoming her home, and she's smiling with them. I kind of got off course a little bit there. She was best known to me for her salads. She would make, she called them salads. And every single time when I would go visit her, she always had her Jell-O salads. She was well known for this. Out of all the cooking items that she did, she was good at making the Jell-O salads, and I always had to try her salads, and she always had them in there. I'll miss those Jell-O salads for sure. She also enjoyed driving around and looking at homes, especially around Christmas time. Enjoyed looking at the lights. She liked to play bingo, and we would go out when I would come up and visit and go play bingo. And she also enjoyed her rum and cokes too. So when I was up here too, I asked Grandma, I said, do you have any, in all your years, is there any advice that you would give? And she thought about that for quite a minute or two. She really thought. She goes, I would just tell people to be kind. Mm-hmm. She said, there's not enough kindness in the world. And so I think that was good. She did tell me that she was at peace. And I'm comforted in knowing that she's now with Walt and Shirley, and that she is finally at peace. So thank you for letting me share my stories with my grandmother. I welcome anybody else that has a few words that they'd like to say. Is that
want to follow along in your folder there is Ecclesiastes 3, selected verses. And sometimes this guy, it's believed maybe that Solomon wrote this, but often this guy is called teacher or preacher. So I'll go with the latter. The preacher says, "For everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven, time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to sow, a time to keep silence and a time to speak, time to love and a time to hate, not my favorite one, but a time for war and a time for peace." Now, I'm going to ask you to lay those down because I'm going to reread it. But this time from Eugene Peterson's The Message. If you don't know what that is, Eugene Peterson was a Presbyterian pastor. When he neared the end of his life, his grandchildren said of him that if Eugene was about anything, it was about making sure that people understood the love that God has for us. And so he first translated the Psalms from the original language, and what he did was he translated it and then paraphrased it. So I call it a transparaphrase because it's not like the Living Bible, which was a paraphrase of the King James Version. It goes much deeper than that. So here, listen to this. "There's an opportune time to do things, a right time for everything on the earth, a right time for birth and a right time for death, a right time to plant and another to reap, a right time to kill and another to heal, a right time to destroy and another to construct, a right time to cry and another to laugh, a right time to lament and another to cheer, a right time to make love and another to abstain, a right time to embrace and another to part, a right time to search and another to count your losses, a right time to hold on, another to let go, a right time to rip out and another to mend, a right time to shut up," he said it, not me, "and another to speak," actually to speak up, "a right time to love, another to hate, a right time to wage war and another to make peace." I always like it when there's somebody from the family, especially when I didn't know the person. When somebody from the family is brave enough, thank you, to stand before the group of people and say something about the deceased, I'll share one of those incidences with you. So this young girl in my congregation unbeknownst to me, had a congenital heart condition. I think it was called Turner syndrome or something like that. But anyway, she was 31 and she had gone to Mayo with this problem with her heart. And on Saturday, she was outside with her family, and it was just a wonderful thing. And Sunday morning early, I got the text from her mother that she had died. 31, right? So the whole point of that is her brother is a radiologist. And at the time, he was finishing up his residency or intern, whichever one comes last. He was getting ready to go into practice for himself. And he was the one chosen by the family to speak. And he stepped into the lectern, and his face just went almost blank. You could tell he was grasping for words. And then he blurted out, I just don't know what even to say right now. I said, damn it! And everybody kind of giggled. You know, and then he went on to tell this wonderful story of Casey as his sister and blah, 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 right? So I got the pulpit to preach the gospel, and I said, well, Jeremy, you did one thing in your speech that I could never do. I could never say, damn it, from the pulpit. Oh, I just did, and everybody laughed. Now, the point of that is to kind of get you loosened up a little bit. Because there's a time to cry, but there's also a time to laugh. And honestly, somewhere in Scripture, it says that you weep at a birth. You mourn at a birth. And you rejoice at the ending. So, unfortunately, you didn't say anything about her momisms. Huh?
No.
No, you did not. And there's one I've got to clean up a bit. Quite a bit. Life is just one blankety blank interference or
aggravation
after another.
Yeah.
Huh?
And a kick in the ass is 1 foot forward.
And a kick in the pants is 1 foot forward.
Yeah.
And it is.
She has a good sense of humor.
Well, I'll take it deeper than that. She said she had a good sense of humor. I'll take it deeper than that. She was a theologian of the cross. Okay? You know, that was Luther's thing. If you're in here and you're not Lutheran, I'm gonna learn you something. Okay, I'm from Tennessee. I am not from North Dakota. As they said of Peter at the trial of Jesus, you've got to be a Galilean. Your accent gives you away, right? Well, you can tell I am not from North Dakota. My accent gives me away. In his Heidelberg Disputations, Martin Luther began this in about 1920 and 21. He talked about this thing, you know, the Theologia Crucis and the Theologia Gloriae. Okay? So the theology of the cross versus theology of glory. And so ladder climbing and all that kind of stuff, you know, thinking we can be good enough to get to God is theology of glory. Understanding that God is with us in that interminable series of aggravations is the theology of the cross. Huh? We cannot separate God the Father from God the Son from God the Holy Spirit. Yet we often try to do that. God the Father is almighty and omnipotent and all-powerful, and but God the Son went to the cross. And God the Holy Spirit is here to help us along. No. God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit is all-powerful, all... God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit went to the cross and overcame death. God used God's omnipotent power to lay all that aside and hang on that cross. That's why Paul in Philippians talks about, you know, that Christ thought nothing of it to lay aside all the glories of heaven to walk this path of humanity with all its interminable aggravations. Huh? Anybody in here whose life has not been an interminable series of blankety-blank aggravations? Oh, good. I'm not the only one. Huh? And I think in that very statement that she shared with you, her momism, yeah. I don't know that she knew she was a theologian of the cross. But obviously she understood something about the God that we love and serve in this world. The God that makes it possible for us to be reunited with those whom we love. The God who loves us so much that he set aside his own power to give us the freedom to make the choices we're going to make, which, by the way, often causes our interminable blankety-blank aggravations. Who was it that said we have met the enemy and he is us? Who was it that said that? Was that Pogo? Everybody know who Pogo is?
Yeah.
The cartoon?
Yeah.
Was it him?
I don't know.
I think so. Yeah, we've met the enemy and he is us. We're our own worst enemy. We bring our own aggravations on ourselves. And the God that is so powerful sets aside the ability to make us automatons and to enter into those aggravations. God allows us to enter into those aggravations. You know why? Because God enters into them right along beside us. Any of you learned to swim at a very young age? I was like 13. I was scared to death of water. And I know the stories about, you know, Dad took me down to the pond. And I like the story better about the mom standing in the pool or the dad standing in the pool with the little guy or girl, holding them while they kick and paddle with their hands. Now that's my picture of God. That we're in this aggravation together. That God entered it with me. God enters your aggravations with you. Even if you brought it on yourself, quit beating yourself up about it. By the way, that last line there was as much for me as it was for you. Okay? Because I'm really good about beating up myself. That's what comes from growing up in a certain kind of family that has a theology of glory. Huh? I'm not a cradle Lutheran. Okay? I'm the worst kind. I'm the kind that came along later and I learned all this stuff, and by God, I'm going to make sure you know about it. Even if you are a cradle Lutheran or a cradle Catholic or a cradle whatever. Right? I'm going to tell you something you probably already know but didn't really think about. God is with us in this room. Now I get to be the speaker. Woo-hoo. Right? But God is with us in this room, in this aggravation of one of those times, the time to let go. Time to let go of what was an earthly vessel and to cling now to the memories, knowing that God will continue to walk with us until it's time for that reuniting. God doesn't leave us. You know, God is not death, but death is in God. And if that confuses you because it's a circular argument, that's what theology is.
Yes.
Okay? God is not death, but God is in death. Or death is in God, right? God doesn't will any of us to die, but God allowed us to make the decisions that put us in that place. And God walks with us through that. So when we talk about at the end, we're going to be with at the end of our time, we're going to be reunited. Yeah. Paul said, for me to live is Christ, but to die is gain. Whether I'm in the body, I'm with Christ, or out of the body, I'm with Christ. So here's the whole thing. You guys knew Donna. And she meant something to you. Different for each person in this room, yet some things would cross over. Because God loves us so much that God went to the cross and God was resurrected, so we too shall be resurrected one day. That whether we're in this body, we're with Christ. Whether we're in this body, we're with God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And when we leave this body, we are with Christ, with God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I imagine in the next several weeks, something that has already started in you will continue. It's called grief. Damn it, why did Grandma die? Couldn't Grandma have stayed around for just another, you fill in the blank, huh? And in those times, that's when we as humans begin to forget that God is with us, and we begin to despair. And despair can lead to deep, dark depression. And deep, dark depression can lead us quickly away from God. So there's got to be something, a hook, that brings us back. And that is precisely the theology of the Lord, or the theology of the cross. That God is in this deep depression with us because God went through all of it with you, us. Don't despair, but if you do, don't beat yourself up. Just don't quit looking for God and at God, because God is right beside you. It's something we have to take by faith, because we don't know how else to take it. Huh? And I think with that, I'll just say amen.
Amen.
Amen. And so, I was actually going to have a song played after your thing, so we'll do In the Garden now if anybody's listening to it. Are you there, God? Ah. To join with me and pray the creed, the Apostles' Creed. Now listen, if I say it different than you, that's okay. All right? Don't try to get all wrapped up in what I'm saying. You pray it yourself. All right? You ready? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Continuing with our prayer, I will pray the petitions. I will say, in your mercy, and your response is, hear our prayer. Almighty God, you have knit your chosen people together in one community. In the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace, in your mercy. There you go. Grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to newness of life, and that through the grave and gate of death we may pass with him to our joyful resurrection, in your mercy. Grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith, that your Holy Spirit may lead us in holiness and righteousness all our days, in your mercy. Grant to your faithful people pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from all our sins and serve you with a quiet mind, in your mercy. Grant to all who mourn assured confidence in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may know the consolation of your love, in your mercy. Give grace, or courage and faith, rather, to those who are bereaved, that they may have strength to meet the days ahead in the comfort of a holy and certain hope, and in joyful expectation of eternal life with those they love, in your mercy. Help us, we pray, in the midst of things we cannot understand, to believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to life everlasting, in your mercy. Grant us grace to entrust Donna to your never-failing love, which sustained her in this life. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, and receive and remember her according to the favor you bear for your people, in your mercy. God, the generations rise and pass away before you. You are the strength of those who labor. You are the rest of the blessed dead. We rejoice in the company of your saints. We remember all who have lived in faith, all who have peacefully died, especially those most dear to us who now rest in you. Give us in time our portion with those who have trusted in you and have striven to do your holy will. To your name, with the church on earth and the church in heaven, we ascribe all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. At this time, we'll hear Amazing Grace.
The sound that saves.
O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, thine life. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive her into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. Let us go forth in peace in the name of Christ.
Physically be with us,